to invite the High Court team for the presentation of the case. Receive permission from our dean please to proceed toward the High Court case. Receive permission from our dignitaries to proceed toward the High Court case. Thank you, sir.
We would like to invite High Court team to present the case of criminal nature of Rama Ramji and others versus State of Madhya Pradesh.
I request Honorable Judge Ms. Vinita Sene to take respective seat.
Counsel of appellant are enacted by Mr. Deepak Singh as appellant advocate number 1 and 2. Ms. Mahima Badoria as appellant advocate number 3. Mr. Himanshu Sharma as appellant advocate number 4. Mr. Hanmat Singh as appellant advocate number 5. Ms. Ravina Kannoj as appellant advocate number 6 and 7. Mr. Vijay Jat as appellant advocate number 8 and 9.
Government advocates are presented by Mr. Rahul Govatia, Ms. Sonu Mukati. Darbana of the case is represented by Mr. Santosh Nargave. Reader of the case is represented by Ms. Sushila Ninama. Stenographer of the case is represented by Ms. Sharda Bangia.
I invite appellants for proceedings.
May it please your lordship. I am appearing on behalf of appellant number 1, Anchaji, number 2, Lakhan. My lord, a police case was registered on December 6, 2013 under section 148, 323, 325, 366, read with 149, 344, 376D and 120 of IPC. The learned trial court has convicted 6 accused and sentenced them to undergo rigorous imprisonment for 1 year for offence punishable under 323 of IPC, rigorous imprisonment for 3 years for offence punishable under 325 of IPC, rigorous imprisonment for 3 years for offence punishable under 366 of IPC. Accused number 7, 8 and 9 were also sentenced for the same offences along with rigorous imprisonment for 10 years for offence punishable under section 376D of IPC with fine of ₹2,000 which has been already deposited, against which this appeal preferred.
Counsel, let me know about the fact of the case.
My lord, as per the prosecution story, complainant Mangilal lodged a report that he was shepherd and came there from village Ghogra, District Pali, Rajasthan. The complainant was in camp on the field of Kailash Bharud at village Lepa. In the camp, his brother Malaram and father Bhimaji were sleeping. At about 2 o'clock in the morning, complainant heard some noise and saw Rama, Bhura, Mala, Anchaji, Jeta, Kalu and Lakhan along with other having lathis. The complainant was caught hold by Jeta and Kalu. The accused Rama assaulted with lathi on the head, hand and back. Upon hearing his hue and cry, his father Bhima and elder brother Mala came over there. Then all accused person started beating to his father and brother. The accused persons forcefully took away his sister. As per complainant, the motive for the commission of offence was that his sister had married with accused Rama and sister of Rama married with complainant. But due to some reason, they were living separately. Hence, accused persons committed such offence, which was seen and heard by Moni Bai and Kamla. Upon report, the prosecution registered a crime. Thereafter, injured were sent for medical examination and treatment. On 28 December 2013, after 22 days, prosecutrix was recovered. She was medically examined and her statement was also recorded. The trial court proceeded with trial. My Lord, as far as my appellants are concerned, the charges upon them are under section 323, 325 and 366 of IPC. My Lord, there were 14 witnesses adduced by the prosecution, among which some of them became hostile. Findings of the learned trial court and depositions made in the learned trial court do not comply with the story. So I urge this honorable court to please find in favor of my appellants. Much obliged.
May it please your lordship, I am appearing on the behalf of appellant number 3, Jeta. My lord, the allegations on my client are under section 148, 323, 325, 366, read with 149 of IPC. My client is falsely implicated in crime as per the offence is concerned. The learned trial court urged error in law and ignored the contradiction and omission in the deposition of witness. As per the section 366 is concerned, the definition under IPC defines kidnapping and abduction of a woman to compel her for marriage. May I not, may I read the whole definition?
There is no need to read the definition. You continue with your argument.
My Lord, as per this present case is concerned, section 366 is not invoked. The act does not come in purview of this section. Prosecutrix was married to accused and she was living with her lover. In view of aforesubmitted facts and circumstances, it is most respectfully prayed that this honorable court may kindly be pleased to assign the judgment of conviction and consequently to acquit the appellant. Obliged.
My Lord, I am appearing on the behalf of appellant number 4, Kalu, whose age is 30 years. The sections implicated on him falsely were section 148, 323, 325 and 366 of Indian Penal Code. The concerned trial court urged error in law with respect to the offence therein. My Lord, in allude to the allegation of grievous hurt under section 325 of Indian Penal Code on my client is untenable. The primitive ground indulged within the conviction is medical report. My Lord, pertaining the medical report of PW7 Bhimaji, whose age is 70 or above, extracts no conclusive proof that the action had caused by my client. Rather, my Lord, referring para number 32 and 33 of trial court findings, abstracts that a field with no light, a night with no moon, and a mind with no exact insight of this place creates the perfect ambience for a person with this attaining age to get the impulsive hurt by falling down on the hard and blunt object like sharp-edged stones or cones within the field layout in the due course for reacting over the incident which was sudden and swift in nature. My Lord, I like to draw your attention towards that in accordance with the prosecution story, PW8 Monibai and Kamla were present on the campsite when this incident happened. They both saw the concoction attack, but they neither reacted over it nor they were injured by it. My Lord, how it is possible to not to counter over the incident of abduction and brutal beating that anguished one's own kin? Consequently, this whole story is just a myth created all over. I request the Honorable Court to contemplate the above arguments and pass the verdict of acquittal or undergo in due favour of my client. Much grateful.
May it please your lordship. My lord, I am appearing on behalf of appellant number 5, Tumala. May I proceed the court?
You may proceed.
My lord, my client has been convicted by learned judge of the trial court under section 148, 323, read with 149, 325, read with 149, 366, read with 149 under Indian Penal Code. My lord, the allegation on my client is that the complainant, his brother and father got injured by the act of appellant. My Lord, it had been submitted by the counsel for the accused that the prosecution witness number 6, 7, 8, 11, along with prosecution witness 3, in his statement said that the incident took place at 2 o'clock at night and there was no light on the spot. In that situation, prosecution witness could not identify the accused. My Lord, page number 14 and para 35, judgment of the trial court. In the cross-examination, the prosecution witness number 1 had admitted that it is possible that the injury can be due to falling or collision. And Dr. Satyam Tari, prosecution witness number 4 in the cross-examination, had stated that Bhima's age is 17 years old. And in this age, the wounds become weak and fracture could be possible due to spontaneous and falling. So my Lord said, the counsel's humble submission is that the appellant is an innocent person and he has falsely implicated in the crime. And the learned of the trial court has committed in errors of law and appreciating evidence available on records. The judgment of the trial courts against the provisional law and contrary to the facts and circumstances available on record. If my lordship satisfied with my arguments, my co-counsel continue with the other fact of this case. Much of my lord.
On the behalf of Appellant Number 6, Gura, the allegations on my client are under Section 148, 323, Repeat Section 149, 325, 344, 366 of Indian Penal Code. As per the offence concerned, the order passed by the Learned Court, my Lord, may I refer Para Number 25 of Impute Judgment?
Yes.
Para 25 clearly mentioned that Gura's name was disposed by PWG mistakenly, which is contradictory in itself. And deposition under Section 164 of Criminal Procedure Code 1973, she had not mentioned Gura's name before. Learned Court finds that deposition of PWG were unreliable. Now coming to my second appellant, Asla ji, the allegations on my client are under Section 148, 323, repeat Section 149, D25, D44, 366 and 376D of Indian Penal Code. As per the offence concerned, the learned judge of trial court has committed an error of law in appreciating evidence available on record that PW3 itself clearly says that present appellant has not committed rape. The deposition of prosecutrix is not stable and suffer from material contradiction and omission. PW3 term was tried on many events during the course of trial conducted by Session Court. My Lord, may I refer Para Number 23 of Impute Judgment?
Yes.
Para 23, in Para Number 23, PW3 disposed that she misinterpreted name of Gura with the name of Asla, which itself hampers credibility of prosecutors. Even prosecution itself declared PW3 hostile, where Asla was not involved as told by prosecutors. As per the FIR lodged by Mangi Lal, Asla was not spotted by him at the place of offence. Along with it, Asla, Ramaram, Akmaji were found fit to perform sexual activity, but no DNA test were performed to create solid evidence. Fit to perform sexual activity is not the sole ground of conviction. My Lord, I urge to the Honorable Court to provide acquittal on aforesaid ground to my client, Asla and Gura. Much obliged.
May it please Your Lordship, I am appearing on behalf of Appellant Number 8 and 9, Ramaram and Akmaji respectively. The allegation on my client are under Section 148, 323, 325, 366, read with Section 149, 376D, 344 of Indian Penal Code. Your Honor, PW3 was married to Ramaram and legally not separated from her husband and still living with his lover Rana. After many tries of my client, Rama, to take her back and live with her, she refused to accept the relationship between them and tried to falsely accuse my client and tarnish his reputation by sending him behind the bars. My lord, PW3 did not reported any pain in genitalia, but it should be reported. If there were repeated abuse, no marks were seen on her body. Uterine swelling should be there, even though she was habitual to intercourse. My lord, PW3 deposed she was with her husband, which disapproves the possibility of finding of 7 to be only and only of accused to be doing wrongful act with her. I would like to refer the case. May I read?
Yes, you may read.
My lord, in case Samira Kohli versus Dr. Prabha Manchanda, Supreme Court held that along with basic information, mental condition of women should be present. But in this case, no such report has been submitted. Your Honor, all of the accused were at the grace of your mercy. In the story of prosecution, London Session Court only considered the angle which has been put up by the complainant and approached the story with soft attitude towards the victim. In our case, the prosecution has malified intention and working in conjunction with prosecution put up a false case. My Lord, in our arguments made in front of this Honorable Court, we have enlightened multiple times situation where major contradiction of facts can be seen, which make doubts and degrade the credibility of the prosecution case. My Lord, previous enmity is the genesis of this malicious case. Their Honor, my prayer to this learned court is as follows. Mere conviction on basis of ability to perform sexual activity should not be considered. Credibility of victim can be questioned on multiple grounds. Therefore, her deposed statements cannot be treated paramount to convict. My Lord, humble us to this court is only seeing previous judgment in criminal case is not sufficient to convict any person because in criminal case, facts and circumstances changes the gist of the matter. My prayer to this Honorable Court is to provide relief to the accused and grace us with acquittal. Much grateful, my Lord.
Yes, Government Advocate.
May it please your Lordship. Your Honor, the appeal initiated by the accused advocate against the judgment given by learned judge of trial court is completely groundless. The trial court has proceeded with fair trial and investigation. The conviction made by trial court of accused Ancha ji, Lakhan, Jeta ji, Kalu, Mala, Bhura, Asla, Rama Ram and Akma ji under section 148, 323, read with 149, 325, read with 149, 366, read with 149 of Indian Penal Code and accused Asla ji and Akma ji under additional section of 376D and 344 of Indian Penal Code and accused Rama Ram under section 376D, read with 120 and 344 of Indian Penal Code are appropriate and valid. The conviction was based on medical examination of prosecutrix PW3. The report clearly shows the presence of human sperm and semen sample in vaginal slide and petticoat of prosecutrix PW3. Also, my lord, the injuries found on the body of prosecutrix PW3 clearly states the act was done forcefully and without her consent. Relying on judgment given by learned trial court in para 20, the details of injuries of prosecutrix PW3 are given, which include swelling on right and left shoulders, swelling on right and left thigh, swelling on right arm, swelling on left ribs, swelling and scratches on breast and scratch marks in front of neck. Your Honor, the above mentioned injuries cannot be self-implicated It was clearly, forcibly implicated by the accused. Also, my lord, prosecution witness Mangi Lal, Mala Ram and Bhimaji also got injured at that time. All accused gathered there with a common intention of hurting and caused normal injury to Mangi Lal and Mala Ram and grievous injury to Bhimaji, as specified in judgment of learned trial court. My lord, relying upon para number 9, 10 and 11 of judgment of learned trial court, kindly grant me permission to read the relevant portion. May
I know the fact mentioned in this paragraph. You continue with your argument.
My lord, the above para includes the injuries of Mangi Lal, Mala Ram and Bhimaji, which clearly shows the brutal beating by all the accused. Now, my lord, advocate of appellant number 1 and 2, Ancha ji, son of Nimba ji, age 15, and Lakhan, son of Nimba ji, age 16, hasn't proved anything in his argument on which basis his client can be acquitted. Indeed, Ancha ji and Lakha name was mentioned in FIR as well. And Mangi Lal, Moni Bai, Mala Ram, Bhima ji, Kamla Bai and prosecutrix PW3 also has given statement against Ancha ji and Lakhan. A lathi was also forfeitured by PW10 from Lakha. Ancha ji and Lakha normally hurted Mangi Lal and grievously hurted Bhima ji. My lord, the learned judge of trial court hasn't done any error of law and conviction made on Ancha ji and Lakha was appropriate and valid. Now my lord, as my colleague advocate of appellant number 3, Jeta ji, son of Teja ji, age 37 years, said that her client didn't come under the definition of section 366 of Indian Penal Code. My lord, the main ingredient of section 366 of Indian Penal Code include kidnapping, abducting or inducing woman to compel her for marriage, and secondly, seducing and forced to illicit intercourse. My lord, relying upon para number 27, page number 11 of judgment of learned trial court, I would like to relive it portion. May I? साक्षी अभियोक्त्री अभियोजन साक्षी 3 के कथनों से प्रमाणित है कि ग्राम लेपा से अभियुक्त गण अंचा जी, लखन उर्फ लाखा, जेता जी, कालू, माला, भूरा एवं असला, रामाराम, अकमा जी द्वारा अभियोक्त्री अभियोजन साक्षी 3 को उसकी इच्छा के विरुद्ध ले जाकर उसका अभ्यपहरण किया गया तथा जंगल में 20 दिन तक उसे अपने कब्जे में रखा गया। उक्त स्थिति में उसका सदोष परिरोध कारित किया गया। My lord, in FIR also, Mangi Lal has clearly said that Jetaji was there and hold the hand of Mangi Lal while Rama Ram was beating him. And after that, they abduct his sister and leave that place. The whole argument cleared the allegation which was putted over Jetaji are completely valid and appropriate. Therefore, my lord, I request to honorable court to sustain the charges and conviction made by learned trial court, and I would like to transfer the responsibility of further argument and conclusion to my friend government advocate. Highly
may it please your lordship, my lord, advocate of appellant number 5, Mala, has made the argument about no presence of light was there at the time all this act was done. My lord, there was presence of light, and for this I rely upon paragraph 13, page number 13 of impugned judgment of trial court. Kindly grant me the permission to read the relevant portion of this paragraph. May I, my lord? My lord, here completely stated by Malaram that he has got a torch and he has seen the faces of all the accused in the light of torch. My lord, I would like to read a judgment of Supreme Court in this context. May I read, my lord? My lord, Honorable Supreme Court, also stated in Shaktipal and Azhar versus West Bengal case, if they know each other, if they are relatives, then they can identify each other even if there is no presence of light, my lord. By their physical attitude, by their way of walking, and by their way of talking, my lord. My lord, it clarified that accused Mala can be identified by Mangilal, Malaram, Imaji, and prosecutics, my lord. My lord, in the initial argument made by advocate of appellant number 4 and in the later part of argument made by advocate of appellant number 5, both the advocate has raised the allegation over medical examination of Bhimaji. My lord, the statement made by Dr. Satyam Tare in the context of Bhimaji about fracturing of bone in this age, my lord, this statement are made in just normal sense. Accused advocate hasn't put anything which can prove it, my lord. So it is very, very clear that such injuries can't occur in one fall, my lord. Bhimaji need to fall down again and again, but there is no such kind of evidence presented by the advocates of appellants. My lord, so I urge to the court not to provide any kind of acquittal to appellant number 4 and appellant number 5. Now, my lord, advocate of appellant number 6, Bhura, and appellant number 7, Asla. My lord, prosecutics in her statement clearly taken the name of Asla and Bhura. And prosecutics also clarifies that Bhura and Asla are involved in sudden attack and abduction. And Asla also raped her for 10 to 11 days, my lord. And also tortured her every single day. My lord, this is also mentioned in paragraph 3, page number 3 of impugned judgment of trial court. My lord, Bhura was the driver of that white car in which prosecutics has been abducted. And Asla also tries to deviate the case by manipulating prosecutics at the name of compromise, my lord. So I request to the court not to provide acquittal or undergone to Asla and Bhura as well, my lord. Now, my lord, advocate of appellant number 8, Ramaram, and appellant number 9, Akmaji. My lord, Mangilal, Malaram, Bhimaji, and prosecutics in her statement clearly taken the name of Ramaram and Akmaji. My lord, advocate of Ramaram and Akmaji is just trying to manipulate the case, my lord. In real sense, all the conspiracy was devised by Ramaram, who gathered all the accused and attacked over Mangilal, Malaram, Bhimaji and prosecutics at the midnight, my lord. My lord, laboratory also specified that there is a presence of more than 2 male sperm at the vaginal slide and petticoat of prosecutics, which certified the statement of prosecutics, my lord. My lord, Dr. Rakesh Patidar also clarifies the capability of Ramaram and Asmaji of doing sexual intercourse, my lord. My lord, for certifying the statement of prosecutics, I would like to read a judgment of Supreme Court in this context. May I read, my lord?
Yes.
My lord, in 3 judges bench led by Justice Ashok Bhushan, court clearly stated that the statement made by prosecutics can be considered as a sole ground of proving rape with her, my lord. So, my lord, to teach the lesson to this shameless kind of people who consider a woman as her property and only use her like a commodity and also try to develop fear in the society, my lord, they don't deserve to be acquittal. So I request to this court not to provide any kind of acquittal or undergone. The conviction made by the trial court is fair and valid. Highly obliged, my lord.
My lord, law says that no person should be convicted falsely just because alibi has created to falsely accused. We acclaim the judgment of the court, but we pray to the court to consider the above arguments and pass the verdict of acquittal or undergo in the due favor of all the accused. Highly grateful.
Appeal has been filed at the instance of 9 accused persons, namely Anjaji, Lakhav, Jetaji, Kalu, Mala, Bhura, Asla, Ramaram, and Akmaji, who have been held guilty and the same convicted under section 148, 325 read with 149, 323 read with 149, and 366 read with 149.
And out of these accused persons, Asla, Ramaram and Akmaji have been convicted additionally under section 376D and 344 of IPC with fine. Prosecution historian believes is that complainant Mangilal on 6 December 2013 has lodged a oral report at police station Kasrawat stating that they are shepherds who travel with their cattle. At present, they are at village Lepa in the field of Kailash Bharu. It was further stated that he along with his brother and female members were sleeping when at about 2 o'clock at midnight. He heard some voices and thus got awake. When he saw that accused Rama, Bhura, Mala, Jeta, Anchaji, Kalu and Lakhan Rewari coming to them, he resisted. At that time, Jeta and Kalu have held his both hands and Rama assaulted with lathi on his head, hands and back. He shouted and then his father, Bhimaji and elder brother, Mala also came. All the accused person started assaulting his father and brother with lathi. At that time, prosecutrix PW3, wife of Rana Rathore, came and the accused person took her forcibly along with them. It was further stated that complainant along with the father and brother could not go behind the accused, but the incident was informed to cousin brother Gopal and Jetaji. Probable reason of incident was also stated by complainant stating that his sister was married with Rama and he was married with sister of Rama. Both the couples were separated and remarried elsewhere. Due to this enmity, Rama along with the co-accused person has committed the offense. Complainant also stated his Moni Bhai and Kamla as eyewitness of the incident. On this oral report, FIR under crime number 550-2013 under section 147, 148, 149 and 366 of Indian Penal Code was registered initially and injured person Mangilal, Malaram and Bhimaji were sent for medical examination. After investigation, offences under section 376D and 344 of IPC were also added. After committed, trial was conducted under case number ST211-2014 and accused appellant have been convicted as mentioned herein above. Resultingly, accused appellant have filed this appeal challenging the judgment of conviction and sentence passed by the trial court. Accused appellant by filing this appeal have challenged the judgment of trial court on following grounds, namely, no incident has alleged has taken place on 6th December 2013 and prosecution has falsely implicated appellant. No evidence is available on record to connect the accused appellant with the aforesaid incidents. There are loads of contradiction and omission in the testimony of prosecution witnesses which has been ignored by the trial court. Counsel for the appellant person has vehemently argued before this court that appellant has been falsely implicated and wrongly convicted by the trial court, and vital contradiction and omission have been ignored. Counsel for the state, on the contrary, has supported the judgment passed by the trial court. It has been stated that trial court correctly appreciated the oral as well as the documentary evidence led by the prosecution. Prosecution has examined as many as 12 witnesses who has been exhibit various documents, exhibit P12, P49, PW6 Mangilal, PW7 Bhimaji, PW8 Moni Bhai and PW11 Malaram have been examined as complainant and witnesses respectively. While prosecutor has been examined as PW3, it is seen from the initial FIR Exhibit P20. Name of the accused, namely Asla, was not mentioned therein. While all the witnesses having the voice that is stated about the presence of other accused persons on the place and their respective overheads.
All the four witnesses, PW6, PW7, PW8 and PW11 along with PW3 prosecutrix have supported the prosecution story except about accused Aslam. PW3 prosecutrix in her evidential statement in para 2 of the chief examination has not stated the name of Aslam as an accused, and further in para 5 has categorically stated that Aslam has not committed rape on her. Trial court in its judgment has no word specifically stated that how the presence of accused Asla on that place. There is no evidence available on record to connect accused Asla with the aforesaid incident. In the considered opinion of this court, trial court has urged in convicting accused Asla for the alleged offences mentioned by prosecution. As far as other accused person is concerned, PW3 has alleged that accused Rama, Bhura and Akmaji have committed rape on her. Medical witnesses Dr. Amrita Pandey, PW5, has found injuries on the person of prosecutress and rape was found to have been committed on her. Presence of semen on clothes of prosecutress and also her vaginal slide has also been proved on the three accused persons. Rama, Bhura and Akmaji found to be physically competent for intercourse. However, accused Bhura has not been named by prosecutors in police statement exhibit P13 as also in her statement under section 164 of CRPC exhibit P14. Therefore, allegation of rape against accused Bhura has not found to be proved. Rape is proved to be committed by Rama and Akmaji. Accordingly, their conviction under section 376D of IPC is correct. Other accused persons have also been correctly convicted under section 366 read with 149, 325 read with 149 and 323 read with 149 along with section 148 of IPC. Their conviction is staying confirmed under the aforesaid offences. As far as the time of the sentence is concerned, it is seen that accused Bhura has already undergone sentence of around 8 years from the maximum sentence of 10 years. Counsel for treating the sentence of accused has undergone for the remaining period. Looking to the fact and circumstances of the case and the time of the sentence already suffered by the accused person, the remaining sentence of all of them except Asla is staying convicted and waived and undergone. Asla is staying acquitted of all charges leveled by the prosecution against him and his bail bond is staying discharged.